It's a quiet news week for Transformers, and we're still more than a month away from New York Toy Fair, so I figured I'd dive into the Patreon listener questions and bring up yet another topic that we could all discuss here today on the podcast. And if you are interested in asking a Patreon listener question, just be sure to check in the description below. We have a whole bunch of different tiers and a lot of cool stuff. And then you could join us on the Discord too and rock out with us. So we have a Patreon listener question from MassiveGains. And MassiveGains wants to know, I don't know if you talked about this on the podcast or if you've ever addressed this idea before, but have you ever considered Transformers as an investment? I listen to other podcasts about video games, magic cards, comics, and how they are investments and a complement to your legit banking investments and blue chip stocks. Just curious your take on that, MassiveGains. Okay, well, this is something that, I mean, toys in general have always had a very unique way that they could be seen as an investment. And I find Transformers even more so has a very unique kind of situation compared to, say, that of Star Wars toy collecting or He-Man or anything of that matter. Transformers has a very specific kind of audience with very specific kind of goals. And unlike the He-Man world and the Star Wars world, we also have that third-party market that affects those investments. It's a big thing to dive into, but I'm going to try my best to get as much out of my mind as you're asking me right here. First thing to start about when we're talking investments, we talk about the idea of you purchasing something at a price, and then down the line, you reselling it at a profit where you make, you know, an amount larger than what you paid initially, factoring in also inflation. You know, for someone to buy a Transformer for $12 and then 10 years later sell it for $15, you could argue, hey, you know, you made $3, but when you factor in inflation, did you really? Did you really? You know, so it's something that you have to think about that too. And I just want to put that as kind of a complete surface to keep in mind when I'm talking about all of this. Now, when it comes to investing with Transformers, the biggest problem that exists within this hobby uniquely is that stuff could change the value of other things very quickly. When we're talking stuff like new stock, new figures, new items, new merchandise, you see fluctuations of numbers all the time. You could have like an Ironhide Classics toy go for $20, $30, and then all it takes is for a newer Classics-esque, Generations-esque kind of Ironhide, a Siege kind of Ironhide to come around, a Masterpiece Ironhide, and then the demand of that figure could absolutely, you know, die completely. Then you have also stuff like mint in box, mint on card market, which is there's also a market where people buy figures, keep them carded, and then kind of hope that the value increases over time when those figures are no longer available in retail and MSRP. And usually it works out if you play the long game, but again, it really has to do with an individual product. You can't just kind of tackle one thing and say, oh, this is, you know, any, like, the guy who went into 2007 into Toys R Us, bought Fast Action Battlers Barricade, mint on card, kept it mint on card, and the crazy thing is, like, we're now more than 13 years later, and the $12 that he invested on it, I guarantee he's probably not going to get that $12 back, you know, even carded. You know, it's that's one example. Let's look at G1. You know, we'll start with Generation 1 from an investment standpoint. Now, there's a lot of guys that, you know, there's the mint and sealed box G1 collectors. They get those, they put those in acrylic boxes, or they get them graded, and they see those as investments. They see those as long-term investments. And again, hey, the lower you buy it, the higher you could sell it, that's great. But The reality is that you better get it really low, because the high number that you're going to expect from it is going to be difficult to achieve because of the uniqueness of the Transformer world. There's more Transformer fans that used to buy, like, people used to buy Generation 1 toys because they were the only representation of that character. Then they only bought, you know, and then afterwards, when those characters got proper representations, like much nicer representations, people stopped looking to those figures. The demand and value of a bludgeon, Generation 1 bludgeon, was predicated completely on the fact that he just didn't have any good toys at the time, combined with the fact that he was a featured character in the Marvel Comics back then. As he started getting better and better toys, the demand and value of that bludgeon has decreased significantly. And that's a very key thing, demand versus value. Because you'll have guys, you'll go to a con, and you'll have guys still asking $150, $200 complete bludgeons. But who's paying it? Who wants to pay that? There might have been a time when the demand existed because there was no other bludgeon figures. There was no Reveal the Shield, you know, Generations-esque kind of bludgeon, or some really good movie toys that filled the gap, or even third party. But as time progressed, people just kind of got their fix through other means. Now, granted, we've yet to get that proper pretender bludgeon in that scale outside of the, you know, Power of the Primes little decoy armor figure, which I still love, but I mean, it is what it is. It's not still that full-size sword-wielding character we would want. But we do have alternatives that have heavily hurt the demand, not the value, the demand of that figure. And that's the key thing, is that if you have no demand, the value doesn't mean anything. You could be that guy at BotCon, TFCon, whatever, that has a mint-in-box Minerva. And Minerva hasn't had many good toys in recent years from an official or unofficial capacity. We have that Masterpiece one coming, which could definitely, like, you know, satiate people's needs for that character. But when there was a time where that was the only Minerva figure, people would actually scratch their chin and go, you know what, maybe I'll drop the $500, $1,000, $1,500 to get that. But as time progressed, Minerva toys came out. That wasn't the only Minerva figure that existed. And despite the fact that that toy is very difficult to get, complete, in good condition, not yellowed, the demand got completely sucked out of this $2,000 mint-in-box G1 Japan Transformer, because people will just get their fix through, number one, a bootleg, which you'd be surprised, number two, a reissue, or number three, a third-party product that's more show accurate. So it's something that heavily hurts that. And again, it goes back to, well, what is investable then in Transformers? If you're saying that nothing is investable, then the stuff that is investable is all stuff in short terms. The sad thing is with Transformers is I personally feel that most of the product is not investable. There is, you know, freak occurrences here and there. Like once in a while, there'll be like certain figures that you go, oh, okay, like this is something that held its value and increased in value. And even then, those individual figures, as time progresses, even their story changes. Best case example, Leader Class Revenge of the Fallen Jetfire. He came out, he was a $49.99 MSRP retail figure in 2009. And then right away, his value skyrocketed after the Revenge of the Fallen movie. And it was kind of the best version of that character. It wasn't the only version, but it was the best version of that character. And that toy would sometimes hit $100, $150. And it was literally just holding that value for more than a decade. And then the Studio Series one came out. And then the Transformers Takara, the best Japanese line, came out. And slowly, the demand for that version has started to even out again. And it's going back to that $49.99, $50 amount, where it wasn't an investment. If you bought a mint-in-box Jetfire for $49.99 plus U.S. taxes and sat on it, did you, you know, and then you sold it years later, now that it's plateaued at $60, did you really make, you know, profit? No, you didn't. You probably just broke even with inflation. So, but if you would have bought it and then that peak happened and then you sold it then, yeah, then there was an investment. But that's the thing. There's no crystal ball, unfortunately, with predicting what is valuable and what isn't, because you could like go, oh man, I got a G1 Shockwave, and you know, to, you know, Hasbro's never going to reissue that because that mold doesn't belong to them. And then all of a sudden, boom, out of nowhere, you got a Siege Shockwave that practically is the Shockwave toy. You have a Masterpiece Shockwave, and then all of a sudden the demand for that one plummets heavily, on top of the fact that the only people that then would be interested in that toy would be people who are Generation 1 completists. And that, I'll tell you right now, has been shrinking and shrinking as years progress. I always, every year at TFCon, make a big note of what is selling well and what doesn't sell well for dealers, and including myself. Anyone who's gone to my parts parties, I have a plethora of everything from every year, from every line, pretty much available. And I see what does well every year. And it always is a curve, you know, the stuff that sells well. But even then, when I think about what I sell that product for, I get stuff relatively cheap. People send me their collections. I buy out stuff. So my cost basis is very low. And then my resale basis is modest, meaning like I end up buying a deluxe transformer for $5 and then selling it for what would have been MSRP cost of $15. So if I was someone who bought it at MSRP 15, I don't know if I'd be able to ask more and be able to move it out of my room. You know what I mean? So it's very complicated. Like, as it stands right now, the best way to make money with Transformers is buy new product when it's brand new, and sell it as quick as humanly possible, because you get the hype train. When it's new product, people will want to buy it, and that's the short-term investments. But the long-term investments, unfortunately, the way that the market is, the way that bootlegs exist, it's just, it's too volatile. It's too scary. You could be a guy that goes, okay, like, you know, what's like, you know, something that hasn't been reissued and that is unique in Generation 1 that I can, okay, you know, I'm going to get Raiden. I'm going to get G1 Headmasters Raiden. And I'll get it mint in box, and I know it's going to be. And then Takara could just easily go, oh, we're making a Masterpiece Raiden. And then to celebrate the Masterpiece Raiden, you know, we're going to do the G1 reissue also in the Encore line or something. And that right away will destroy the value of it. It doesn't change the fact that you have an original 1987 Headmasters Japan Raiden, and its expected value is still X amount of, I would say about 1,500, 1,200 mint in box. But the point is that who's paying that though? There is a value to it, but the demand, like I said, going back to that, you know, important word, the demand completely disappears afterwards. And when that demand disappears, then you got a problem. Then you're stuck with it. And then whatever you paid for that thing, which is very important too, whatever you paid, hopefully not a lot, but you start catching up to that. Let's say you paid $500 and hope to get $1,500. As time progresses, you know, the inflation starts to creep up on you, and then the demand as time progresses starts to disappear completely, because more and more people start just getting a bootleg, start just getting a Masterpiece version, start just getting, you know, the reissue that Takara did. The best example that I always give is Generation 1 Stepper. Generation 1 Stepper, which was a Black Jazz Target Master repaint. This guy was a $500 premium item from Generation 1 Headmasters that everyone was trying to get back in the early days of BotCon. I would have to say, like, you know, let's go like BotCon 99 up until 2001. Then he got reissued in the Takara book box versions, and that market died because everyone was willing to get that one for one reissue. And then it got reissued by Hasbro in America, which put even more of that same mold on the market. And that was that. You know, now it's like no one is gunning for that. They haven't done an Art Fire yet, I'm surprised. But it's just, it shows that just how much things could change very quickly for very specific toys that were once, have high expected values of stuff. it's a very difficult market. And at, you know, like I always say, like, what stuff that sells very well? I'm not saying valuable, but sells very well. Beast Wars toys sell well. Animated toys sell well. But if you're someone who has a Beast Wars Deluxe Rhinox, good luck selling that, because we have the Generations one, which completely defeats the purpose of the original 1996 version. And then, hell, who knows? We might even get a Masterpiece one day, which will then make that Generations one have even less of a demand. So it's the same thing. Look at Dinobot. You know, like, you know, that original Dinobot toy, outside of a completist of original Beast Wars toys, no one's going to want that old choppa face, you know, mutant head Dinobot. They're going to want, you know, to have the Masterpiece. And if, unless you're someone that's like, okay, you know, let's see, I bought a mint on card, you know, Beast Wars Rocky Bubble Dinobot for $9.99, you know, back from Toys R Us back in 1996. And I kept it mint on card. You know what? You'll probably get $50 for it. But the question is, who's giving you that $50? You know what I mean? Who is, you know, maybe a mint on card collector, but that's such a small bubble of the audience. And when you're doing investing, one thing that you really want to hope for is that you cast a wider net when it comes to demand. Because for you to sit around hoping for that one guy to buy, yeah, all you need is that one guy because you only have the one product. But you might sit forever. You know, and then when you're talking like, you know, okay, I got to put it on eBay, and then there's eBay fees, or you have to do conventions, and that's table costs, and the conventions sometimes, you know, it's more than table costs, it's flight, it's hotel, it's, you know, food for the day, and if it's multiple days, sometimes parking, travel, it's something that you have to ask yourself, where is your profit margin for the investment? And it makes it very difficult to figure that out if you don't know what's going to be the next hot thing. My personal opinion, like I said again, the best way to make money and invest with Transformers is on the short term. It's to literally go, okay, you know, look, Toy Fair is coming up, right? Toy Fair will go like, hey, we're going to be doing, you know, Earthrise Hoist and Earthrise Grapple. And then all you have to do is go, okay, what Grapple and Hoist toys came before? Oh, these ones are way better than the ones that have come before. There's no Masterpieces. You could pick those up and try to flip those, and you might get a couple bucks, but be sure to flip them quickly, because after those come out, if you hold on those for a year, who knows? Maybe like all of a sudden there's going to be a Masterpiece announcement. Maybe all of a sudden there's going to be a third party to scale of that Deluxe announcement. It's something that you can't hold on to it for too long, because things change so quickly in this hobby. And on top of that, there's very specific people that are happy with, again, owning a bootleg, owning a reissue, owning a third party, so that official product sometimes just doesn't have that luster. I know so many people that were just heavy collectors in TFCon staff that have literally unloaded stuff, or alternatively, like, just bought only reissues, or happy owning a bootleg or owning a third party version. It's crazy, and I got to see that firsthand. And my opinion, once again, is if you do want to invest, you got to keep it in the short term. Never forget what you paid for something. That's another big mistake that I see a lot of people do, is they buy a bunch of stuff to resell, and then they totally forget what they paid. And then when it comes to pricing it and stuff like that, a year later, they totally forgot, and then they end up underselling it and losing money. It's tough. And like, if you buy a case of four brand new Earthrise figures, and you, let's say for easy math, you know, the case costs you $60, right? So that means it was $15 a figure each. So if you're going to ask, let's say $25, right? So if on a good day, that $60 case, if you sell the whole case, you're going to make $100. It's $40 profit. But here's the problem. Let's say you only sell three of them, right? If you sell only three of them, yeah, you made 75, right? So, okay, you made $15 instead. That's still safe. But if you only sold two of them and you're stuck with the other two, you're actually at a loss of $10, and you're stuck with still two more figures. And as time progresses, if those two figures are the duds, or they have no interest or demand, you're in trouble. that's a big problem I see with a lot of guys that, you know, you go to TFCon or you go to local toy shows and you see them with old third-party merchandise. Hexatron, City Commander, you know, stuff that's just like, oh man, they're going to be stuck with it forever. And you get worried, what did they invest to get that stuff for it to sit in their stock? That it, to me, if you have a something that you paid $100 and it's never going to get sold, that's a $100 loss. It takes space on your table, it takes space in your house, and it's a loss. So be very careful with that. Long story short, I feel like I've been, oh, it was 20 minutes now. I feel like I've been rambling, but long story short, short-term investments, new product comes out, judge the market, see what exists of that character, because it's always about the characters with Transformers. See what's of that character, get it as early as possible, get it as cheap as possible. You know, don't overpay its MSRP. Get it at its MSRP, or if on sale, even better. And then sell it as quickly as possible. But never, ever, ever. And I feel like I'm teaching scalpers what to do. But I mean, that's the reality from an investment standpoint. But never, ever think of a long term with a lot of these, because if you get stuck with it, you're in trouble. You will be in trouble. Yes, there has been cherries that, you know, oh, hey, yeah, but this one increased in value after 5 years. Yeah, there is. But usually 9 times out of 10, you're stuck with something that doesn't do that. And then even that one of the nine, that one there that actually did do well, after that 5 years of it being a great item, all of a sudden that one plummets and then something happens. I mean, it's the name of the game, man. It's just the name of the game. And that's why Transformers, I feel personally, is not really that great of investment. I think there's a lot of other things that are a little easier to predict and have I don't want to say have a better fandom for it, because I think Transformer fans are awesome. But I think that Transformer fans have a very unique situation that other toy lines don't have. That really, how do I put it, that really preserves the value, which unfortunately it doesn't. I know that He-Man fans suffered the same thing, where a lot of He-Man fans, a majority of their vintage toys got reissued and stuff, and that kind of hurt their market. And same thing, look at Transformers. Look how much of original Generation 1 has been reissued. Now imagine if all of that had not been reissued and how that would have kept the value. But anyways, that's all I got to say about that. Hope that long-winded answer answers your question. I want to know what other people think about it too, because I've always had my opinions, but I want to know if anyone has had similar experiences, getting a product, holding on for it for a bit, and then maybe getting it at a profit or at a loss. Let me know what you think, especially if you're dealers. I know, again, dealers are always my brothers at the shows. All my guys, Mega Toy Fan, you know, Brett, I love him. He's probably one of my favorite, you know, guys to rap about this kind of stuff. But let me know what you think about it, and drop a comment. And again, if you're interested in asking a Patreon listener question, be sure to check out below in the description and join the Patreon. And once again, thank you, Massive Gains, for the question. It was an interesting one.